to you by Penguin.
A Dutiful Boy by Mohsin Zaidi. Read by Mohsin Zaidi.
For Mamutar, the uncle every child should have. For my niece, Ayabear, in the hope she never needs me the way I need him. And to every young person struggling with their identity, you are not alone. Author's note. The names and other identifying features of some people, places, and events have been changed or merged in order to ensure that they are not identifiable, so as to protect the privacy of individuals. This is a story based on memories of my experiences. Not everything that is faced can be changed, but nothing can be changed until it is faced. James Baldwin, 14th of January, 1962. Prologue. Her promise to meet him was only to placate me. It was hollow, like our love had become. For 10 years my mum had resisted, fought against the idea as though she were holding off an army at the castle gates. And yet, here we were. A day I thought would never come. The drawbridge about to lower. In battle, are you ever really ready for the white flag? In the moment, the focus is on the fight, so when surrender comes, the impact of it might leave you dumbfounded. But my plan had worked. I'd played the long game and won. My heart didn't jump for joy or skip a beat. It lay inert and heavy in my chest. My boyfriend and I would visit her and my dad at their home. A home from which it felt like so much of me had been exiled. Now, though, we would both go there to eat Pakistani food, cooked with her hands, with her history. Tastes from a faraway place to usher in an equally foreign concept. My parents lived in a London suburb 6 stops east from Mile End on the Central Line. Those 6 stops were almost as familiar to me as the family home itself. Usually, I travelled alone, and at each stop, a part of me would fall away. At Stratford, I would forget what they had said to me. At Leighton, I would discard what they had done. By Leightonstone, I'd put down the anger I felt towards Islam, dear to them and once so dear to me. At Snaresbrook, I'd suppress my anger towards them. Then South Woodford, the penultimate stop. That's where I would leave behind what I cherished most of all, my love for him. To take it with me would have been to disrespect, to demean it. On this day, though, no part of me would be left behind. Not my love for him, and not him either. Not his whiteness or the sharp blue of his eyes. If only I could dim the bright blue, which I loved so much, just for that evening. Make him smaller, moulded to fit neatly into their closed hearts. Hours before we left, I lay on the bed feeling as blank as the ceiling I stared at. I couldn't do it, I told him. As I spoke, cracks formed in my numb veneer, beneath it a seething rage. I told him I was sorry, and I was sorry. I was desperate to go through with it, but consumed by anger towards her, at myself, and at the rules that had built a wall between us. But then we were on our way, on a train heading for the unknowable. I held on to him more tightly as we got closer, for once hanging on to those things I had become so accustomed to leaving behind. We stood outside the house. 2 men. My dad opened the door. I asked him where she was, and his frown made my heart sink. Part 1. Chapter 1. My dad's back was shredded and covered in blood. He had done this to himself, in front of me. I was 7. On the first 9 evenings of the 10 holiest days in the Shia Muslim calendar, my family and I would join the rest of our community at mosque, separated by gender, to beat at our chests with our hands. Standing in a wide circle under fluorescent tubes emitting a cheap, bright light, the most impassioned beaters would huddle at the front, topless, in the hope of inflicting just a little more pain. Bodies leaning back, hands raised high in the air, held there for a moment to gather momentum, then whipped down onto reddening brown torsos. Perfectly in sync with one another and with the Urdu words that rushed out of my jolted lungs. The methodical sound of skin slapping skin, escalating in my head and urging me to beat harder. But on the 10th day, in the car park of the mosque located just off a busy East London road, the grown-ups would use blades rather than hands. My dad, who would do anything for his faith, gripped a black handle that fastened together three small chains connected to long silver blades. They glistened in the light like a child's plaything. I gripped my little brother's hand, the two of us standing with other spectators. Members of St. John's Ambulance stood by, watching in disbelief, unable to rationalise what they were seeing. I was more enthralled by their reactions than those blades. Those I had seen before. The disapproving shock on these white faces, I had not. They seemed scared, but they had nothing to be scared of. My dad, fiercely devout, might do this to himself, but he would never hurt anyone else. They blinked each time the knife struck skin, as if the pouring blood had splattered into their eyes. I stared at my dad's back as he screamed. It was an emotional shriek, not a pained one, followed by another and another and another. Blood flying through the air, landing on people's clothes and my face, staining my memories red. His eyes were shut as he continued to rip apart his back. Crimson streams traced lines down his torso towards his legs. He looked in my direction. "I do this for you, my son, and one day you will do this for me," he said without a word. Among the clattering of blades, I felt a sense of excitement, a sense of belonging to a small group of only the most devout Shias, those closest to God. A belonging that would grow stronger as I grew older, strong enough that, one day, I too could shed blood and live. To me, Shia Islam was not just a religion. It was not simply a set of rules, and it was not a belief. Like other religions, it was an all-encompassing world into which I was born, with its own history, its own calendar, its own food, clothes, traditions, books, maths, laws, and even its own deviance. The first words whispered into my ear on the day of my birth were the same as those heard by every Muslim baby. They were of the kalma, telling me there was one God and that the Prophet Muhammad was his messenger. Islam's borders transcended geographical boundaries. On one side were people like me, who carried the faith in their hearts. On the other side were infidels, non-believers. There was no such thing as a dual identity. My only anthem was the call to prayer that rang out into every corner and every eardrum 5 times a day. The azan, the same poetic ancient Arabic tones that had flown purposefully across mountains and oceans for over 1400 years, seeking out followers of the Prophet. Before I could walk, my parents taught me to lower myself into prayer, mimicking their greetings as they met with their God. Unlike the majority of Muslims who hold their hands together, my parents prayed with their hands by their sides. We were a minority, told by other Muslims that our violence, albeit self-inflicted, meant we were not Muslim at all. We were under attack, and so my parents instilled the importance of holding onto my identity more firmly, fearing that, unless I did, it might be taken away. As a Muslim, it was expected that I read the Quran in its original ancient Arabic at least once before I die. Mastering the language and the holy book's 114 chapters took years. Every day after primary school, I spent 2 hours at Quran class, held on a white bedsheet spread across a local Shia woman's tiled kitchen floor. A brimless round white cap slipped off my head as I dragged my feet to class. Glimpses of my black hair burst through the patterned holes. I surreptitiously glanced at the girls in hijabs on the other side of the room as we rocked back and forth while studying the Arabic patterns that went from right to left. Taught to read aloud words with no sense of their meaning, the sounds made little impression on my immature ears. A long, transparent, plastic ruler policed my thoughts, whacked firmly down in front of me by the teacher.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.